Playing that shit fest of a game that was Hard Driving, I just had to play something that was actually worth a damn. Something to cleanse the sins of Hard Driving away and start anew. So the game that I chose to review is none other than that classic Genesis title itself, Sonic the Hedgehog. I absolutely freaking love the Sonic franchise. It is my all-time favorite video game series. Just look at all the Sonic games that I own. Part of the reason I love the Sonic series so much is because it's the very first game that I have ever played. I was 3 years old when I started playing video games. My brother, my sister, and I had two consoles at the time. We had an NES and we had a Genesis. My brother and sister, seeing as that they were older than me, played the NES a lot, so I played the Genesis more often than they did, seeing as that the NES was usually occupied by them. And thus, Sonic became my main man. But as always, before we jump, or rather sprint, into the review, let me explain how Sonic the Hedgehog came to be. In order to understand how it all started, we're gonna have to go back 2 years prior to the first game's release. Back to good old 1989. Ah, yes, 1989. That year was chock full of events. Glam metal had reached its apex in terms of popularity. The Berlin Wall fell. The Wizard was released in theaters. It was an eventful year. But 1989 also marked the release of Sega's 16-bit masterpiece, the Genesis, Mega Drive in Europe and Asia, in the USA. Prior to the release of this wonderful machine, Sega had an 8-bit console, the Master System, which was competing with both Nintendo's NES and Atari's 7800. More so with the NES and the 7800, though. Now, despite the awesome library of games that the Master System had to offer, it didn't receive the attention or fanfare that the NES was given. The Master System sold well, but due to Nintendo's near monopoly on almost all third-party developers, the Master System somewhat lagged behind its main rival. That was all until Sega decided to leap ahead and usher in a new generation with their Genesis console. The Genesis set a new standard. Most consoles back in 1989, including the NES, were only 8-bit, whilst the mighty Genesis was 16-bit. Throughout 1989 and 1990, Sega enjoyed quite a bit of success with the Genesis, even with the release of Super Mario Bros. 3 on the NES. However, eventually Nintendo unveiled its own 16-bit masterpiece, the Super Nintendo Entertainment System, along with another Mario game due to be released in 1991. Sega had to think fast. Even though Sega was gaining as a company and third-party devs were willing to support the Genesis, Sega was still not yet, or at least not as much, established as Nintendo was. So they decided to create a new character to represent their company. Technically, Sega did have a mascot already, but they were trying to market the Genesis to an older, more mature crowd. This new mascot had to compete with Mario, but he had to be cooler and faster than him, too. This new mascot also had to demonstrate the power that the Genesis was capable of. During the creation of this new character, ideas were thrown around on making him either an armadillo, a kangaroo, and even a rabbit. Sega eventually decided to settle on an animal that could roll into a ball so that he would have a method of attack. A choice was finally made between a porcupine and a hedgehog. Sega chose the hedgehog due to its known speed, yes, hedgehogs are actually fast, and being a relatively unknown animal in America. Originally, the new character was known as Mr. Needlemouse, and his first appearance was actually in the arcade racing game Radmobile as a rear-view mirror ornament. He was also originally colored cyan, too. Mr. Needlemouse was also originally part of a rock and roll band made up of other assorted animals, and he also had a girlfriend named Madonna. Sega eventually scrapped the idea of a rock band and girlfriend because they thought that these two things would simply over-garnish the new IP. Mr. Needlemouse's name was changed to Sonic to emphasize the fact that he was fast, and they changed his color to a darker shade of blue to match the Sega logo. And thus, Sonic the Hedgehog was released on June the 23rd, 1991. Right. Sorry, folks. You can tell that I love the games a lot. That's why I gave you a little history behind the game, and even a little history behind the... Right. Let's dash into Sonic the Hedgehog. So the game starts off with that glorious sound, and we get the intro. I have to say that that is one hell of a way to start off a game, and that music is so damn catchy. Speaking of the music, earlier games in the Sonic franchise were very well known for their musical score, and Sonic 1 is no exception. Every song in this game, from Green Hill Zone to Scrap Brain Zone, is so damn catchy that you will find yourself humming along to these tunes, or even making up your own lyrics to go along with said tunes, because they are that good. The music is very well composed for this game. If you're wondering about the plot, well, it's short but sweet. Basically, the nefarious Dr. Robotnik, aka Dr. Eggman, starts kidnapping small animals in and around the tropical paradise of South Island, and uses them to power his army of robots. These robots were designed for both defending the Doctor himself and for finding the Chaos Emeralds, which there are only six in this game. The seventh Chaos Emerald wasn't added until Sonic 2. However, the heroic Sonic the Hedgehog catches wind of what the Mad Doctor has been doing and sets off on a mission to find the Chaos Emeralds and stop Robotnik. And some of you folks out there are probably wondering why Robotnik was using animals to put in his robots, but later on in the series stopped. Well, I have a theory. I can't prove it, but I'll at least explain. I think he was using the animals like a bio-power source output of some kind. Basically, he would put the animals into the robots, and the robots would be powered by the bioenergy from the animals. I think Robotnik started using microfusion batteries later on to power his machines, and just left the little critters alone. I was getting to that before I was so rudely interrupted. Anyway, again, can't prove this, but I'm pretty sure the reason that Sega didn't add a seventh Chaos Emerald is because they weren't really sure if they had a series yet. They didn't know whether the game would be a hit or miss with the consumers. That, or convenient plot writing for the second game. The graphics are stunning. Now, they're not as good as the graphics seen later in Sonic 2, Sonic CD, and definitely not as good as what was seen in Sonic 3 and Knuckles, but they are far, far, far from ugly or generic looking. But, visuals aside, what about the gameplay? That is what made the Sonic games Sonic games, after all. Well, this is where it all began, folks. Speed? Check. Smashing robots to smithereens? Check. Halfway markers? Check. Spin dash? Sorta. Yeah, the spin dash technically wasn't added into the series until the second game hit. You can do like a half-assed version of the spin dash by pressing down while Sonic is running, so it's there, kinda. It just wasn't perfected yet. Other than that, everything else is great, and most importantly, it's got that fast-paced gameplay that we all know and love. The levels, which there are six, by the way, are laid out like a cross between a roller coaster and a Formula One racetrack. The layouts of levels twist, turn, loop-de-loop, and go up and down in every which way that was possible to do in video games back then. Speaking of levels, each of the six zones, as they're called in this game, are all broken into three acts each, are all themed differently, and are all unique in their own way. For instance, Green Hills Zone is themed after an island oasis, complete with palm trees, waterfalls, big flowers, you know, tranquil island stuff. Marble Zone is based off of a medieval dungeon, with traps such as weights, spiked weights, and even magma. I think Sega was trying to go for like an homage to 80s dungeon crawler games with this level in mind. Spring Yard Zone is a city-based level, and I don't know whether they were trying to go for like an urban San Francisco feel or an urban Brooklyn feel. I tend to lean towards urban San Francisco myself due to the colorful look of the city. Labyrinth Zone... I really must express myself about this. Now mind you folks, that this is just my personal opinion. If you like or even love this particular level, that's fine. That's all cool, you guys can like slash love what I don't. And you know, it's not required that we all like the same stuff and
Yes! Get over there! Yeah!
Right, I suppose so. Anyway, I really fucking hate this level. First of all, the Labyrinth Zone is ginormous. This wouldn't be a problem if you weren't on a time limit. Yeah, I should mention that when you begin each level, you are on a time limit of about 10 minutes. Now, that's not a bad thing. I'm not even ranting about that. What I am ranting about is that Labyrinth Zone is very large and it's filled with water. And water slows you down quite considerably. And speaking of water, Sonic can't swim. And if he stays submerged for too long, you lose a life. Now, this is a trait that has stayed with Sonic since the beginning, obviously. And I think it was meant to show that Sonic, like any superhero, has a weakness. And his just happens to be water. That's all fine and dandy, I just wish that this level wasn't so long and designed like a 2D version of a Wolfenstein 3D level. Other than the fact that I hate it, Labyrinth Zone does look nice, you know, being based off of ancient Greek ruins and all. And the music in this level is also really catchy and upbeat, so it has those two things going for it at least. Starlight Zone is based off of what I can assume are unfinished skyscrapers interconnected with each other. Starlight Zone is a breath of fresh air compared to Labyrinth Zone. For one thing, it's fast-paced rather than bogged down with endless mazes and water, and it's nowhere near as big as Labyrinth Zone was. Finally, we get to Dr. Robotnik's hideout, Scrap Brain Zone. As you would expect, this area is very cyberpunkish, complete with a dark and polluted atmosphere, futuristic buildings, conveyor belts and gears pretty much everywhere. The only thing missing is industrial rock music. Don't get me wrong, the music is very good in Scrap Brain Zone, and it's my favorite piece of music in the entire game. Though, I suppose if you wanted to, you could mute the TV and put on some KMFDM whilst playing this level. At the very end of each zone, you face off against Robotnik himself in a boss battle. The boss battles are pretty interesting. Robotnik is always in a new kind of egg mobile. That's actually what they are called. These egg mobiles range from trying to kill Sonic with either a wrecking ball, fire, and even breaking the platforms away from which Sonic stands on. These boss battles are interesting, but I would say that they're kinda meh. They got better as the series went on, though. Besides the six main levels, there are also six special stages to find in this game. These special stages can only be entered through a giant ring at the end of Act 1 or 2 of the six zones. A prerequisite for entering these special stages is to have at least 50 or more rings by the end of the level. I don't know what kind of psychedelic drugs they were taking at Sega when they came up with these special stages, but whatever they were dropping, be it acid, shrooms, or peyote, they managed to create a very trippy yet pretty cool special stage. Though there are some folks out there that really don't like these special stages, and even though I personally like them, I can understand the flack that these special stages get. Some say that they're really disorienting, and they are. Not for me, though. I've been playing this game for a long, long time. The special stages constantly spin in a circle, meaning that you're never gonna get a solid footing. Also, due to the fact that these stages are constantly moving, you have to be very careful where you go, because one wrong move can send you smack dab right into a goal. And if you hit a goal, you lose a chance to gain one of the 6 Chaos Emeralds. And while we're on the subject of Chaos Emeralds... The Chaos Emeralds serve as an integral part of the game's plot. As I mentioned before, one of the reasons Robotnik ordered his army of robots to move out all across South Island was to find the 6 Chaos Emeralds. Now, when the game was first released in America, the plot, as with pretty much any game that wasn't an RPG of some kind, was very simple. But according to the Japanese instruction manual's plot synopsis, the emeralds, when applied to science, could be used to power military-grade laser weapons and ballistic nuclear missiles, which would definitely explain why Robotnik wanted them in the first place and why Sonic was trying to stop him. Gaining all 6 emeralds gives you one of two endings. If you finish the game and you have all the emeralds, each of the multicolored gems starts spinning around and make Green Hill Zone even livelier than it was before. Failing to get all 6 of the Chaos Emeralds results in Sonic just giving you a mildly annoyed look, and Robotnik juggles the emeralds that you failed to get under a sign that says, "Try again." And that's the first Sonic game, folks, and I give it an E for excellent. And how could I not? It's a video game classic. Sonic 1 was the first game in a legacy of many games to follow. I happen to be one of those fans of the series that believes that a very good percentage of the games that followed this one were good. Sure, you got the occasional bad Sonic game, but ask yourselves, are there any video game franchises out there that have a perfect track record? Besides my opinion on Labyrinth Zone, there is one negative that does come to mind when playing this game. 3 out of the 6 levels, i.e. Marble Zone, Scrap Zone, and Labyrinth Zone especially, are more slower paced than the other 3 levels. But I think Sega did that intentionally to see if gamers would like the new fast-paced gameplay, or if they preferred the slower-paced gameplay that was seen in the Mario games. Sonic and Robotnik are very imaginative and unique characters. Hell, they still hold up pretty well today as video game icons. And think about this, if it weren't for this game, we wouldn't have gotten awesome titles like Sonic CD, Sonic 3 and Knuckles, or even Sonic Adventure. The series definitely has its faults, but it still holds a special and beloved place in my heart as a gamer. Like I said, first game I ever played, and thus, I grew up with the series. Hey Shasta, what's your opinion on the first Sonic game? Of course you do. And of course I do. And of course a lot of other people do as well. And that's why in the next review, we're going to be taking a look at how the old Blue Blur outdid himself and made a lifelong friend with a two-tailed fox in the second Sonic the Hedgehog game. See you in the next review, everyone. Concrete tongue.